the workshop started. So K.V. Subramanian is going to tell us about tourist questions in the Grassmannian.
Thanks. Yeah. Audible? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Madhusudan. Thanks, Shubhangi, and thanks, Tommy, for inviting me. It's been a lovely week here, actually. And weather-wise, it's improving also. So, this talk is going to be I think it'll be a short talk. I don't have too much to say, though the number of slides, if you look at it, is large. But that's because I have many on the same slide. So what I will do is, so there is no complexity theory here, but of course it connects up to GCT, and in fact, if you thought we don't have a talk on group theory today, you're wrong. This is going to be a talk with group theory, and so I will take you through what will actually finally construct the kind of things that Ketan was talking about, and this is a very explicit construction, as explicit as you can get. So I'll define the various terms as we go along. So this is joint work with my colleague Santamarai. He's really an expert in the area, and a PhD student at CMI, Sarajit Bakshi. So I'll just give a brief introduction to the Grassmannian and the kind of geometric invariant theory that we need, at least as part of the GCT program. And we'll solve a baby version of the kind of problems that GCT eventually hopes to solve. But this baby version itself is non-trivial, I think, and we will solve a very baby version of that. So the object of interest is the Grassmannian, so which I will define soon. So we'll fix E. And dimensional vector space over the complex numbers. The Grassmannian is really we thought of as a collection of r-dimensional subspaces. So there is it comes with two parameters, r and n, n being the underlying vector space that we are looking at, and we are looking at the collection of all r-dimensional subspaces. And how do we specify each of these points? We'll be specified by an n cross r matrix with the columns of the matrix actually spanning the given subspace. And so for us, we will actually embed this object in a nice projective space. And the way this embedding is done is fairly classical. It goes back almost 100 years, actually. So we look at all R cross R subdeterminants of the given matrix. So we have an N by R matrix. We know it has rank R. So look at all R cross R subdeterminants. And this gives an embedding in this really large space. This has n choose r dimension. So we take every r cross r subdeterminant, evaluate it, and get a collection of numbers. And p really goes into this point specified by these n choose r coordinates. So I might evaluate the first r rows, the subdeterminant corresponding to that. And I know this is a point inside this projective space because I know it has rank R. Therefore, there is going to be an R cross R subdeterminant which does not vanish, and therefore, not all these numbers here are zero. Yeah. It is classical that actually this is really a subvariety of the projective space, and one can write down a collection of quadratic equations which actually define this object in projective space. So when I think of this object in projective space, it has natural functions on it, and the linear functions on it are really those n choose r coordinate function, because now they are, we have an embedding, and inside that space these are all linear functions. And but what are polynomial functions on this? Actually, polynomial functions on this are also very nice. We look at only homogeneous polynomials because this is a subspace of this is a projective variety. So we're only going to look at homogeneous polynomial functions because those are well defined. It turns out that there is a very nice description of the collection of polynomial functions on this subvariety. And in fact, in one of Ketan's talks, he in his open problem session, actually, he mentioned about having what are called standard monomials for certain varieties he believes will be important. And these are the sort of quintessential sort of good objects in that sense. They have very good standard monomials. So I will define that in a moment. So what we will do is, we'll look at a partial ordering on subsets. In our partial ordering, we'll look at, what happened to this? So we'll look at two R subsets each. So think of these R subsets as defining our determinant. So I'll take one R subset and take the other R size subset, and I will say the natural partial ordering on subsets, which says this subset is less than this if the first coordinate is less than the first coordinate here, the second is less than the second coordinate, and so on. So you would look at this R subset, this partial ordering, and then I can when I look at polynomial functions, I'm going to multiply determinants, because the linear functions were determinants and polynomial functions are going to be products of these, at least monomials are going to be products of these linear functions, and therefore a monomial really looks like an L degree monomial really looks like a product of some determinants, and we say this monomial is standard if under this partial order I have J1 less than or equal to J2 less than or equal to J3 less than or equal to JL. Yeah, so it's a theorem that goes back to Hodge in the 1930s, and this was extended to a large extent by Seshadri, Lakshmibai, Musili, and a lot of other people actually. And so this is a good exposition of this is in Seshadri's book, which you will see a reference for later. So what this says is that if I look at all standard monomials of degree D, which means I'm looking at monomials of this kind where J1 less than or equal to J2 less than or equal to JD, they are really a basis for the degree D component of the homogeneous coordinate ring of the Grassmannian. So as I run over, so really we know, it is very nice in many ways, and we will actually see a use of this in the problem that we are going to look at. Yeah, so the thing to, so what this really means is that when I want to look at some property of the Grassmannian and I want to think of it in terms of functions, it really suffices to look at standard monomials and try to reason about whatever property we are looking at with respect to these standard monomials.
Is this specific to the field, or is it just all fields?
I'm working over complex numbers. This works over any field, but at this point I'm only looking at complex numbers. Yeah. So what is the Grassmannian? Well, it's really a homogeneous space. So if I look at GLN mod PR, where I look at n cross n matrices and I look at this subgroup of matrices, which is really sort of a block like this. So you have an R by R block here and an N minus R by N minus R block here, which is non-zero. Then the Grassmannian is really a homogeneous space in the sense that if I take any point, I can multiply it by an element of GLN and get another point. And what is this parabolic subspace? This is really the subspace which fixes E1 to ER. If I look at if I fix a standard coordinate basis E1, E2, ER, and if I look at the stabilizer of this subspace, the stabilizer is precisely this, it matrices of this kind. And under this quotienting operation, I can identify two subspaces whenever this happens. So the way we are looking at Grassmannian as R-dimensional subspaces, you can think of it in this quotienting sense also. Yeah. The reason I'm introducing this is because this gives a very natural stratification of the Grassmannian actually. And this stratification comes from the sort of stratification that we know of GLN. We know that you take matrices, there is a natural LUP decomposition of matrices. And there is a similar sort of decomposition that I see that one can write down of the Grassmannian. It is going to be a union of cells like this. So I have it sort of here, I think. So if I look at, close this. I just close this?
No, just pull out the plug.
Just pull out the plug.
Okay. Oh, he did it for you.
Okay. Okay. So if I look at this, if I take B as the set of all upper triangular matrices, and this is my P, then the Grassmannian really looks like, recall that we are really looking only at sort of subspaces. So if I take, maybe I need to come back to this, sorry.
Yeah, it's
painful. So I want to say that really it is a union of objects like this. So you take your upper triangular matrix and take a permutation of 1 to r, which I can assume always is written this way because of this quotienting operation. So it really looks like objects like this. Take an upper triangular matrix, multiply it by a permutation matrix of this kind, and then a permutation matrix which where I can assume that w1 is less than or equal to w2 is less than or equal to wr. And it really looks like objects like this. And an easy way of sort of understanding this is if I give you a W, what subspaces are present? So suppose I look at n equal to 7. So these are three-dimensional subspaces of a seven-dimensional space. And I look at this as a W that I'm looking at. So then I'm really going to pick out subspaces which have which is non-zero at this point, which is non-zero at this point, which is non-zero at this point. Then I can use this to zero out these coordinates, and I can use this to now zero out this coordinate. And really, if I pick out a subspace which has non-zero entries here, then this gives me what an open cell of the corresponding coset BW PR mod PR. And in the closure, what I pick out is things which could be potentially zero here, but we'll certainly have zeros at all these points where I have written zeros, and even these could become zeros, but they should still continue to be a three-dimensional subspace, that is all. Yeah. So if I do this, and so as I said, if I fix a W and I look at the matrices which have non-zero entries precisely at W1, W2, and WR, and you use them to sort of zero out the other things in that corresponding rows, and I put I put stars at the other place, then that really gives me an open cell of this particular. I get an, and I take the closure of that. So the reason one does this is because this gives me a very nice cellular decomposition of the Grassmannian. I can write down the Grassmannian as a union of objects like this, where this is really the open cell inside this big thing. And so what one can do is to which is what we really end up doing also in this paper, that one is trying to look at a certain quotient construction of the Grassmannian. The general quotient construction is hard, but it turns out you can actually look at quotients of these corresponding objects which are called Schubert varieties. So these Schubert varieties are really you specified by little w, which is a permutation of 1 to r, that's all. Yeah, so 1 to r going to any one of 1 to n. So the Grassmannian itself is a particular Schubert variety. It is a Schubert variety given by 1 going to n minus r plus 1, 2 going to n minus r plus 2, and r going to n. So if I take the closure of that, so in this figure that I had, if I look at this, then I have non-zeros at these points, and this, if I take the closure of this, I get every possible three-dimensional subspace. Yeah. So the entire Grassmannian itself is a Schubert variety in that sense, and the Schubert varieties are sort of nice objects.
Question. I remember these Schubert varieties
can also be labeled by partitions.
Yes, they can be labeled by partitions
with
also.
Permutation, and then to this permutation, there should correspond the partition.
Yes, yes, you can label it by partition.
How do you obtain it?
Yeah, I can tell you offline. It's not so important for this.
Yeah, I have a conjecture, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
So
far, so clear?
You'll have to restart that full screen.
Oh, that's strange.
That's because it, I think, yeah, the resolution changes when you put it
out. Oh, okay, okay. Sorry. Well, now I won't need to pull it out for some time at least.
Yeah.
Okay. So far, so good? Yeah. So the object that we are looking at are r-dimensional subspaces of a fixed vector space, and we have a nice sort of cellular decomposition of this. So that is where we are so far. And if I look at a particular Schubert variety, what does it pick up in its closure? The open set we know. In its closure, I pick out all the smaller Schubert varieties, smaller in the same partial order that we defined. I can talk of W prime being less than W. If W prime of 1 is less than W of 1, W prime of 2 is less than W of 2, and all the way up to R. So now, as I said, we had a standard monomial theory on Schubert variety, on the Grassmannian, and this actually descends down naturally to the Schubert varieties. So if I look at a coordinate function, if I look at the determinant of the R cross R submatrix given by J1, J2, JR, then this will be non-zero. Will not be identically zero. This will not be identically zero only if each of these indices is less than the. So remember, the Schubert variety is parameterized by W. So if I look at the R numbers that I get by plugging in W1, W2, WR, if I will put it, I will get. So I mean, it's very easy to see that it is, if any of these indices is bigger than WK, then the corresponding coordinate there is actually zero. In that corresponding vector that I had, I said I'm going to have non-zeros only sort of in a in something which looks like this. And therefore, if you give me an index where J is, suppose J1 is bigger than W1. If J1 is bigger than W1, then Then W1 is 1 means I need a 1 there, but then the potentially the things below it are all zeros. Yeah. So if I'm looking at a particular coordinate function, if I'm looking at this coordinate function evaluated on something, if I'm looking at, say, the determinant of the row 2, row 4, and row 6 on something which has W of 1 being 1, that determinant is going to be 0 on this Schubert variety. So I mean, if you've not followed it, it's you can ignore it. It's quite straightforward. I'll just write it down, actually. So what it really means is that if I look at the Schubert variety W and I look at the coordinate functions that survive and I look at standard monomials, the standard monomials that survive on W are those standard monomials for which J1 is less than or equal to J2 is less than or equal to JD. This we anyway needed in the definition of standard monomials. And if this is also less than or equal to W, then this survives. This is not identically zero, that's what it means. It could vanish on some points on your Schubert variety also, but it is not identically zero on that Schubert variety. So therefore, for example, if I look at this, if I take n equal to 7 and r equal to 3, and I'm looking at this particular Schubert variety 3, 5, 7, then if I look at the determinant of 1, 2, 3, the determinant of 1, 4, 6, 1, 5, 6, I multiply all of them, then each of these is less than or equal to 3, 5, 7 that I started off with. So therefore, the product of the monomials spanned by the determinant of this times the determinant of this times the determinant of this, that is going to be not identically zero on the Schubert variety described by 3, 5, 7. Now, on the other hand, this is going to be 0 on the Schubert variety, say 2, 5, 7, because you've written 3, 5, 7, and this determinant actually vanishes on all subspaces of the Schubert variety 2, 5, 7. Yeah. So So the takeaway from this is that if I give you the W, then I can really write down the standard monomials on XW.
Yeah. Okay.
So what are we looking at? We want to understand the torus quotient of the Grassmannian. So this is a question of interest. So what is the torus here? So we are looking at diagonal matrices. We are looking at diagonal matrices coming from SLN. And of course, this naturally acts on the Grassmannian. So if I take a diagonal matrix and I write down my N by R matrix, well, the diagonal matrix multiplies T1, the first element of the diagonal matrix, sort of just multiplies the first element T1 multiplies all the entries in the first row, the second element T2 multiplies all the entries in the second row of the corresponding matrix. So therefore, I have a natural action of the torus on the Grassmannian. And since this is an action of the torus on the Grassmannian, I have an action of the torus on the homogeneous coordinate ring of the Grassmannian. And how is this action given? So as we said, if I know that all polynomials on this are spanned by standard monomials. So therefore, I need to only tell you what is the action on a standard monomial. So if I give you a standard monomial and that standard monomial has so I think I have a slide here. So once again, I'll have to. So as I said, I won't unplug this. Yeah. Okay. So here is my N by R matrix. I have a diagonal T1, T2, Tn. And if I multiply this, of course, this is going to scale up all the entries in the first row. This is going to scale up all the entries in the second row and so on. And I, of course, I'm going to get another matrix, which is which has rank R. Yeah, so this gives me another point. Yeah, so if I then when I look at say the determinant of say the first three, suppose R was 3 and I look at the determinant of the first three columns, what happens to the determinant of the first three columns when I multiply it by this? That determinant becomes so suppose I look at determinant of, let me write it down perhaps, so let us look at R equal to 3. And suppose I look at determinant of say 1, 2, 3 times 1, 2, 4. Well, this determinant just scales up the first row. Therefore, I will see T1 squared, yeah, times T2 squared times T3 times T4. Then what happens? That determinant will go to this determinant now under the action of the torus. So, which is what I have in this slide here. So I really know how what is the action of the torus on standard monomials. If I give you a standard monomial which is indexed by a semi-standard tableau SS, then T dot X is really look at the number of ones in that semi-standard tableau, look at the number of twos in that semi-standard tableau, look at the number of n's in that semi-standard tableau, and this this monomial gets scaled up by this factor. Yeah. And the question of interest is really trying to understand the GIT quotient of this. The GIT quotient in the sense...
is that how you denote it? I denoted it GR in slash.
Yeah, I think there are some people write it on the right, some people write it on the left. And I think if you ask mathematicians, they write it on the right, left for some reason. A lot of mathematicians write it on the left.
French,
I think. Yes.
Yeah. What's the significance of this quotient?
Yeah, I'll tell you. Yeah, in fact, that is really... So, it has really a nice connection to classical problems that people are interested in. So, if I look at the vector space of matrices of rank n cross r, then really I have a commuting action of an object that I have not defined, I will define it, of nt cross slr. So, I'll come back to this once again. Sorry. So here is my N by R matrix. So I have an action of the torus on the left, but I also have an action of SLR on the right. And these two actions commute. Whether I multiply this matrix first on the left or I multiply it first on the right and then I do it, I get the same object. So these two actions are commuting. But if I look at this action, what is it going to do? this action is going to scale up all these rows. So if I think of these as now points in projective space, really when I scale up a row, I'm thinking of this as n points in projective space PR of dimension r minus 1. Then really when I just, so therefore this point really goes back to itself, because all that has happened is every coordinate has just got scaled. So this point remains the same. So if I give you these collection of points in projective, if I take these collection of points and I look at the torus action, what I really get is n points in projective space. Yeah, under the action of the torus. And then one could be interested in this action, the action of SLR on n points in projective space, a very classical problem. In fact, the r equal to 2 case is really the case of binary forms. So if I look at, so therefore, when I want to study the action, so, but I could have done this the other way, and this is where this is the approach that we take, and it of course all this was known. So I could start with a matrix M and first look at the quotient with respect to SLR. But what does SLR do? It just multiplies every R cross R determinant by the determinant of this matrix, which has remained unchanged because this is a determinant one matrix. So really, this embedding, that what I call the Grassmannian, is really the quotient of n by r matrices under the action of SLR, because under the action of SLR, two n by r matrices will go back to themselves actually. So, of course, when I'm doing that quotienting, I have to be careful that I retain really full rank matrices. Yeah, that is important. So the matrices which don't have full rank are going to be in the null cone in the sense of Kazan. So really, when I look at this quotient, I'm really left with points in the Grassmannian. And then I'm trying to understand, take this quotient out by SLR, I get the Grassmannian, and I'm looking at the action of the torus now. And this is really the same problem as the one of classifying R points in projective space under the action of SLR. The two quotients are going to be the same, whether I quotient first from this side, or I quotient and then quotient this, or I quotient this and then I quotient this, I'm going to get the same final object. So this is the real interest to study this. Yeah, and of course, I didn't mention this, I could have even reordered these points, you see. Even then, as points in projective space, they are the same points. So this is what I meant by NT in my...
So every element in the quotient space corresponds to a set of points, which are, and different elements are non-isomorphic, is that?
Every element in the
quotient space.
Yes. So what one wants to do is, in some sense, it is really the group. So I will explain it in a very short while, actually. So when I'm quotienting, there are a lot of complications which arise. So we'll come to it.
Yeah.
So there is a commuting action. So we looked at the action of T, but n of t is really t semi-direct product, the permutation group. And when I think of it that way, then really I get these two quotients are really the same. I should actually be a bit careful and put, but I am ignoring some things, but that is not too serious. So really the problem that we are looking, so although I is really the, we are trying to really classify n-tuples of unordered points. Unordered because I am also looking at, in addition to the action of the torus, I am looking at the action of the permutation group on the left. Yeah. So when I am looking at this, the problem that we are looking at, namely the quotient of the Grassmannian by the torus, is really the quotient of n points in projective space under the action of SLR. Yeah, it's the same problem. So we want to really classify endpoints in projective space, and very little is known about this actually. In fact, when R is bigger than 3, almost nothing is known. We would like to get hold of generators for this ring of invariants. We would like to get hold of relations, and if you look at it, this problem, in fact, the generators were known as far back as in 1895 by Kempe, and it was only in 2005 that Howard, Ravi Vakil, Snowden and Milson actually showed the relations among the invariants actually.
Okay.
Okay, so now what, now coming back to your question, now what do we mean by quotienting in this case? So yesterday Vishnu introduced the notion of a max spec of a ring. We will actually introduce a slightly different notion. It's not so what we look at, if I give you, so recall that when I look at the coordinate ring of the Grassmannian, we had a sort of grading by degrees. We said we're looking at degree d polynomials, homogeneous polynomials. So if I take a ring which is graded like this, I call it a graded ring. And if I look at graded ideals inside this, graded ideals which are maximal. So recall what Visu did yesterday was he took a ring and said, look at maximal ideals. And we know from Nullstellen and Zartz that maximal ideals really correspond to points. So in the same way here, if I look, I need to look at graded maximal ideals, and they will really correspond to actual points in my projective space corresponding to this graded ring A. So for, if I start with a Grassmannian, for example, and if I look at its homogeneous coordinate ring and I look at all the maximal graded ideals, they really give me honest points in my projective space. Yeah? In the same sense that when I take a ring and I take maximal ideals, I get points in the variety. In the same way, you get this also.
Yeah.
So in then what is quotienting mean? Well, quotienting means what we take the degree d piece, the degree d piece of the homogeneous coordinate ring, look at t invariants. Yeah, I look at t invariants, and then I look at the set of objects, I collect all these for different d's, and then I look at the maximal ideals here. Yeah. So the final quotient that I'm interested in is really a quotient like this. I mean, it looks very complicated, but it's actually very, very quite simple. So at least in the example that I will give you, it is quite straightforward. So we'll come to that soon. So one thing that we will need is the notion of so what are we looking at going back here? So I need to find, I need to look at this. I need to look at T invariants inside this degree D piece. Yeah. So I will do the same thing here. So I will say a point is semi-stable for the action of T if there is a homogeneous T invariant polynomial which is non-zero at that point. So we start with the Grassmannian. If I take a T invariant polynomial and I evaluate it. If for every t invariant polynomial, if for this point I find some t invariant polynomial which is non-zero, I say it is semi-stable, and it is.
Saying it's not even a null cone, just to make the connection.
I'm saying that it's right here. Okay. Yes. So points which are not semi-stable are points for which every t invariant polynomial vanishes, and that is what we call the null cone in the talks in the last 4 days. Yeah. So really when I'm quotienting out, since I'm looking at T invariants, I need to find points on the corresponding variety for which at least one T invariant does not vanish. And when I'm quotienting out, I need to throw away all those points where every T invariant vanishes. So that is really what is always done. And so there is a we need something slightly more than this. So I say a point is stable if not only is it semi-stable, furthermore its orbit should be closed. Orbit should be closed in the standard sense actually. And I want the stabilizer of that point to be finite. Now this is the technical, when I need it, I will tell you why I need it. So what is the final, what happens is the following. So when I construct this T quotient, what one can actually show, so this is the, this is the theorem of Mumford actually, Mumford going back to Hilbert also, that when I construct this T quotient, really I have a surjective map from points which survive. These are points which survive, which for points for which there is at least one T invariant polynomial which is non-zero. And really I get a map from this to the quotient that we are looking at. And this quotient, if I take a point here and I go back here under this pi, it will turn out that two points map to the same point in the quotient if and only if the closures of their t orbits don't have non-trivial intersection. This comes back to the problem that we were looking at.
KV, I just hope you're aware of time.
Yes, I am.
10 minutes.
Yes, I am. So the pre-image therefore contains a unique closed orbit. So two points will map to the same point out here if their orbit closures intersect. It's coming back to the question that we were all interested in. When do two points? So the question of whether two points have their orbit closures intersect is really the question of whether under this map they go to the same point in the quotient space. Once again. So in this case, it is known that when I take R and N co-prime, then the theorem of Skorobogatov in 93, which was rediscovered by Kannan in 98, says that semi-stable points are the same as stable points. Now what happens here is if I have semi-stable points is equal to stable, then really I'm getting a classification of the orbits properly, because all orbits are then closed. And therefore, this quotient is really a quotient space of, so every point which all points in the same orbit get equivalence classed under this map. Yeah. Okay. So it turns out that So now what we are going to do is we are going to look at, so as I said, if I take, we know how a standard monomial indexed by a tableau is acted upon by a torus invariant. It really that. So when is something going to be a torus invariant? A standard monomial is going to be invariant if I write down that standard monomial, if the number of 1's is equal to number of 2's is equal to number of 3's is equal to number of n's, then that is going to be standard, because then I know it gets scaled up by this factor. But if all these numbers are the same, then it gets scaled up by this. But of course, this is an SLN, therefore this determinant is 1, and therefore torus invariants are So actually this allows us to immediately show the following theorem, which was proved by Kannan and Patnaik in 2009, that there is really a minimal Schubert variety admitting semi-stable points. Yeah, minimal in the sense of the order that we defined. Yeah, and this allows us to also show that the T quotient of this is actually smooth. Yeah, so maybe I'll just, so what we have is we are looking at, so let me give the proof of this. So if I assume R is N, then, okay, let me just write down this. So I know that if I want a particular, I want a standard monomial. So if R and N are co-prime, then the first time this can happen is if I'm looking at a product of 7 determinants. If I take the product of 7 determinants, then I can make sure that the number of 1's that I see is equal to number of 2's. Because every time, recall, these are my linear coordinate functions. Determinants. I have to look at monomials of this kind and multiply them out, but I need the number of times I access row 1 to be equal to the number of times I access row 2 to be equal to the number of times I access row 3 and so on. So therefore, if I write down this particular standard monomial and I start filling it up by putting exactly R1s, R2s, R3s, R4s and so on, I will get this standard monomial, and I know for sure that this standard monomial is non-zero on this Schubert variety 357, and it is going to be 0 on every smaller Schubert variety. And since I have sort of filled up my tableau this way, it's easy to see that this is the smallest Schubert variety for which I will find some T invariant which is not identically 0. So this is the minimal, and this turns out to be the minimal Schubert variety by just filling it up. And so what one is saying is if I look at this Schubert variety, in general, this is what it is. In the case of R equal to 3, N equal to 7, I require that 3 times 3 is bigger than 9, 3 times 5 is bigger than 14, and 3 times 7 is equal to 21. So, this is an example. Okay. So what the general problem, as I said, if I want to construct the quotient of the Grassmannian and the torus, that is hard. So we are looking at a very special example, namely just look at this Schubert variety given by 357, and we write down all the torus invariants on this. And I know that this is the smallest Schubert variety for which I can expect a quotient to be non-zero. In fact, that's what we show that, and in this work, we actually explicitly realize this quotient. So what do? First, we write down all the standard monomials which are T invariant. So one can easily check. So these are standard monomials on the Schubert variety 3, 5, 7. So I really need a filling of a 3x7 tableau with numbers from 1 to 7, which each number appearing exactly thrice. And if I do it in this case, one can exhaustively check that these are the 7 standard monomials I will get on this Schubert variety, which are T invariant. Okay, so that so far so good. So what we then show is that what we want to do is, so we know this ring. So what we actually show is that this projective, these 7 monomials allow us to give a map from the T quotient to projective 6 space. By taking every point here, that's just evaluating on y1, evaluating on y2, evaluating on y7. Yes,
I mean that's it. Yeah.
So what we actually show is that these 7 monomials that I have give me an embedding of the quotient into this projective space. And furthermore, if I look at the coordinate ring of this quotient variety inside P6, it is actually projectively normal, which means that it is actually a normal variety. It has some nice properties that algebraic geometers typically look for. So the theorem that we finally have is that this quotient of this minimal Schubert variety is nice to describe. We have an explicit description of this. So we can write down not only the quotient variety, we can write down the relations also among the 7 generators. Yeah.
So I'll come to that next.
So I'll ignore this proof. The fact that the GIT quotient is actually smooth and normal. So to show that it is projectively normal, what I need to show is that the degree 7 invariants that we wrote down generate the entire ring of invariants, T invariants, on this particular Schubert variety. So if I take all possible T invariants on this Schubert variety, every such T invariant can be expressed as a polynomial linear combination of the y1, y2, y7 that we had. Yeah. So that will actually conclude the theorem that this Schubert variety that we have, the quotient that we have constructed, is actually projectively normal. So for that we require one more large thing. So if I look at, I'll just give you a hint of the proof. The proof uses some fairly standard tools from Schubert varieties. So recall that we were looking always at standard monomials. So when I write down a determinant and I write down another determinant and it happens to be non-standard. In this case, so I'm looking at the determinant of 1, 4, 5 multiplied by 2, 3, 6. So then one can actually check that this determinant can be straightened out into a sum of these determinants. So if I take any, say in this case, a 7x3 matrix, and I write down the determinant of these rows times these rows, then you can actually check that it can be written as a determinant of some standard monomials, the sum of. So this is something that we actually need to do. So to show that this is projectively normal, I need to show that every degree, so we know that the smallest degree in which I see invariants is r times n. Therefore, I might see it in 2Rn, 3Rn, and so on. So what we show is that every IRn monomial can be written as a product of degree 7 monomials. And we actually show that these monomials span the homogeneous coordinate ring. we show it by this. And these are the relations that we write down among these standard monomials. And how do we write it down? We just put the semi-standard tableau corresponding to y1, the semi-standard tableau corresponding to y4, put it next to each other, and then use those straightening laws that I wrote down. Those straightening laws allows me to write down an equation of this kind. So we get what are the 6 equations, and we actually show that if I look at this variety, if I look at C y1 to y7, and we have a surjective morphism to the T quotient, the invariant ring. And one thing that we need to do is to actually show that the relations are all generated by these relations. So that is the only thing that I need to finally show. And that just follows from a very, So there is a fairly interesting theorem. It was used, in fact, I didn't know of its existence till I saw a paper of Ketan in GCT3 where he actually uses this. So this says, if I want to show that relations are generated by zero, okay, then I'll stop here. So what we actually show is that the T quotient is really this coordinate ring modulo these relations. So that is the final theorem that we actually have. So we have a sort of very explicit description of the quotient variety in this case. And just to sort of conclude and show you the why study GIT quotients when there are many reasons to study it. You would really like to understand the null cone. In fact, even the orbit closure of the determinant can be seen as the image of a certain GIT quotient actually. And of course, the big open problem here is give me explicit separating invariants for the torus quotient of the Grassmannian, full Grassmannian. Now that seems a bit hard. And a perhaps even harder question is give relations among the generators for the Grassmannian and give it perhaps in a succinct form in the sense of a circuit perhaps. Yeah. So these are, of course, the questions.
Yeah. Okay.
Any questions?
Thanks.
What is this diamond lemma? What is it?
So the diamond lemma, basically it's some kind of a reduction system. So exactly like we have in Grubner basis, if I give you a monomial. The fact that a monomial has a unique expression in terms of the rewriting rules.
Right.
Yeah. That's all we need to show. Yeah.
Have you considered the action of the symmetric groups of permutation matrices instead of torus action? Just permuting the columns, rows in your set. Because this corresponds to the so-called code equivalence in coding theory.
Okay.
Anyway.
I haven't thought about that.
Yeah, so you can talk.
Other questions? Okay, thanks, Gabby.
Yeah. Thank you.
Back at 3:35.